Hi, everybody. It is October 19, 2017. Baby boomers, do you remember this?
Dum dum, deedle dum dum, deedle dum dum, deedle dum dum. There was a turtle by the name of Bert, and Bert the turtle was very alert. When danger threatened him, he never got hurt. He knew just what to do. And cover, duck, and cover.
He did what we all must learn to do.
You
and you
and you
and you.
Duck and cover.
Be sure and remember what Bert the Turtle just did, friends, because every one of us must remember to do the same thing. That's what this film is all about. Duck and cover.
This is an official civil defense film produced in cooperation with the Federal Civil Defense Administration and in consultation with the Safety Commission of the National Education Association.
Produced by Archer Productions, Incorporated.
Wow, doesn't that bring you back? Duck and cover. As if that was going to protect you from a nuclear bomb. Duck and cover. Those school drills where we would get underneath the desk and put our hands over our head to protect us from a nuclear bomb. So, listen to this. This was CBS This Morning on March 8, 2017.
Geologists are out with a very startling warning that Southern California is overdue for a major and possibly catastrophic earthquake. A new study says it's expected to hit along the San Andreas Fault north of Los Angeles. It could have a magnitude of 7.5 or higher. That's big. For the first time, scientists are closer to knowing when it could strike. CBS News Science and Futurist contributor Micho Kaku is a physics professor at the City University of New York City. Good morning to you, Professor. When I went to see you in the green room, you said, I'm here with doom and gloom. But let me tell you, I grew up in high school and junior high. We've been hearing about an earthquake coming in California for years. What makes this different?
Well, before it was all hocus pocus and black magic predicting earthquakes. And I was born in California, 10 miles from the San Andreas Fault, living under the shadow of the big one. Uh-huh. Now we can quantify this. And we now know that the San Andreas Fault is locked, loaded, and ready to rumble. Oh. We now realize that the people of Los Angeles are living on borrowed time. We now know that by digging into the soil, we can go down 1,200 years into the past, looking at soil laid down hundreds of years ago, and we find 10 major earthquakes in the last 1,000 years. The difference in time is roughly 100 years on average.
Yeah.
The last big one was 160 years ago. Mm. So according to one calculation, we're 60 years overdue for another big one.
You're talking about the great 1857 quake, right?
That's right. It was a huge 7.9 earthquake that was so big it actually liquefied the soil north of Los Angeles, like halfway between Bakersfield and L.A.
And the tremors in that quake, by some reports, it lasted up to 3 minutes. Is that right?
So we're not talking about just a few seconds, like maybe in a Northridge-type earthquake. We're talking about an earthquake that lasts for minutes. And also, the U.S. Geologic Survey did an estimate of property damage, of what could happen if the 1857 earthquake happens today. The numbers are frightening. $200 billion in property damage. That's billion with a B.
Yeah.
50,000 people injured, 5 major skyscrapers toppled because of a gigantic earthquake, 7.8 in this study.
Well, you're not sweetness and light this morning with the information you're giving, but it is important. So if we live in that, if people who live in that area, what would you recommend them to do other than freak out?
First of all, don't panic because the next big earthquake could happen decades
from now. That's counterintuitive, Professor.
Did you hear that? The next big earthquake could happen decades from now. So, experts say that an earthquake in California is inevitable, but they don't know when this is going to occur. Considering what we have been living with these sick, psychopathic, elitist nut jobs who are bringing in a lot of weather events with their technology, man-made hurricanes, flooding out, over 1 million homes in Houston, the fires in California, deliberate. Much evidence now is being provided that directed energy weapons were used. We have no telling what they could do. And they don't care too much about life. So, could they induce an earthquake? Absolutely. You know that we have this technology in which they can do it. So California had this drill for earthquakes today. 10.4 million people registered to participate in this drill in California. But it wasn't just California. It was Germany, it was Iran. This was a global earthquake drill. And I just want to bring your attention to this. 671 earthquakes in California in 30 days. The past 30 days, 671 earthquakes. Now, I know that you guys get an awful lot of earthquakes, but 671, isn't that a lot, even for you guys? This is a list of all of the earthquakes, and the earthquakes that are in red are 3 and over. You've had Greenfield, Mammoth Lakes, the geysers, I know you had one. That was 3.2, I believe. Julian, California, which I believe is in San Diego, 3.4. I do think that you need to really pay attention to what's happening with these earthquakes. So this statewide earthquake drill set for 10:19 a.m. It went on today. The BART train participated, and it slowed down. And everybody at 10:19 a.m. was to duck and cover, and hold on. Get underneath a table, put your hands over your head, and hold on. That was the drill. Alrighty then. I do want to bring your attention to Dutch Sense. For all of you who don't know who Dutch Sense is, I think that you need to subscribe to his channel and pay attention to his earthquake videos, because Dutch Sense has been pretty much right on the money in predicting a lot of the weather events when he was doing weather. I think he's now just focusing on earthquakes, but tornadoes back in 2011, he was able to predict where they were going to occur. Well, now he has been able to predict earthquakes. So this is really an important channel to subscribe to. And I will link below to his channel. But today, he actually simulated the earthquake drill for everyone. I'll play just a few minutes of it.
Thrown at you in an earthquake that you should secure in place now. The shaking has stopped and the drill is now over.
Okay, guys, and again, you are underneath a table or desk, or you are looking around your house that you know where you're going to go. Now, this is a large earthquake. It's carrying on longer than expected. It's massive movement that's happening. You are now realizing in your structure that you may need to actually exit the structure. And in this case, you are quickly but calmly making your way towards your exit plan of your current structure. Whether you're at work, whether you're at business, whether you're at home, you are now making your way either towards the door, and you are inspecting the area on the way out to make sure that there's nothing that could fall in the way of you trying to make your way out of the building. Again, it's a very large earthquake. It's a 9.0 that's happening on the West Coast, and you are still shaking. It's going on for over a minute and a half. carrying on, you're hearing cracking in the walls, you're feeling plaster fall on the table on top of you, you're assessing whether or not you need to exit the building. Now an aftershock is hitting. Okay, so aftershock is now taking place. It's carrying on much longer than you were expecting. Things are, again, all over your house. They've fallen down. And at this point, you are either grabbing your bug out bag and out the door, and when you're going out the door, you are inspecting your area outside to make sure there's nothing that could fall and hit you on the way out, or if it's going to, you can make it out quickly. When you're seeking a place outside, you're moving yourself away from the building and you're trying to get it furthest distance between you and any large objects that could be falling. At this point, the earthquake has been going on for nearly 2 minutes. It's about the size of the Japan megaquake. There's people outside hunkering down on the ground. There's buildings collapsed. There's smoke rising. There's even a few fires breaking out at this point. And this is just the first 2 minutes of the event. Now at this point, if you're living along the coast, something starts to come into your mind about something that you've heard in the past, which is a tsunami. Okay, if you're living on the west coast of the United States, or if you are living on the east coast of the United States, or if you're living on the south coast of the United States, or anywhere else on the planet, at this point, when a large earthquake has struck off your coast, you are now considering your elevation as related to the tsunami that will be developing off this megaquake happening out to sea. And then if you are a prepared person, you've got a NOAA weather radio either on, either in your bug out bag that you've grabbed and you've gone outside and you're now fishing through, grabbing your NOAA weather radio to turn it on to see if there's any tsunami warning. You hear something like this.
The National Weather Service has issued a tsunami warning. I repeat, National Weather Service has issued a tsunami warning for coastal areas of northern and central California, including the following counties: Sonoma, Marin, Napa, San Francisco, San Mateo, Contra Costa, Alameda, Santa Clara, Santa Cruz, and Monterey counties. An earthquake with a magnitude of 8.9 has been detected approximately.
Okay, and you've heard that now. You hear that on the NOAA weather radio, and you are now enacting the second portion of your plan. The shaking has pretty much stopped. It's still ongoing. You're feeling some aftershocks. People around you are starting to get up and walk around. Your house might be standing. It might not be. You may have pets inside. You may not. At this point, driving your car is probably going to be pretty hard because either there's down power lines, down buildings on the streets, or people that are all over the streets, and you're now thinking about the inevitable. You are thinking about the tsunami that could be generated and be to the coast within 30 minutes or less due to the fact that it's only 50 miles out to sea and the fact that it's traveling at the speed of approximately a slow jetliner. So it's traveling very fast. You have 15 to 20 minutes to try and get out. Let me show you what you need to know about a tsunami. First of all, most coastal areas have tsunami, well, signs. They'll usually be on the side of the road, tsunami evacuation route, and they're for cars. Well, unfortunately, if you are here and it's struck off the coast of Oregon and it's coming down to the coast of California, anywhere along in here, let me show you what you need to do. You need to know ahead of time what your elevation is. Now, I'm going to turn off all my place marks and show you how to do this very easily. You can download a copy of Google Earth, and you need to do this ahead of time. You can't do this when the earthquake is struck. You're not going to be getting any computer alerts because either your power is going to be out or your computer is going to be on the floor or the internet's going to be out from downed, well, communication lines, severed connections in the ground. So you're going to need to know a few things. And now I can turn off this feed, by the way, and we can get that out of here. Okay. You'll hear a ding one more time. I apologize about that. So zooming in here, we're going to just pick an area off the coast of Oregon or California. Any one of these areas will suffice since most of them all have a few hundred feet between the shore and the interior of the coast. So just zooming in randomly on Smith River right here, we start at ground level, which is right along the seashore, which is beach level. Now, I'm going to move my mouse around here using Google Earth and look in the lower right-hand corner down here. Hopefully, you guys will be able to see this. Down in the lower right-hand corner, when I move my mouse around, you'll see ELEV, elevation,
and it'll give us what our elevation is. So right at the beach, we are at 0 foot, right? Okay. So if there's going to be a large 100-foot high potential tsunami that's coming in, everybody who's below 100 feet is going to need a tsunami evacuation plan. So assuming you're living in town right here, let's just use this little town as an example, you're right at 0 foot, maybe 3 to 4 feet above sea level here in town. And then it goes up a little bit, up to about 15 to 20, then up to about 45 feet or so. This whole town is about 45 feet above sea level. So you have a tsunami evacuation route, and it's most likely the highway here, and it's going to be taking you up to a higher source that's not going to get bottlenecked by traffic. Well, look where how it goes. It goes north to south. Let me give you a tip of advice. Every second that you spend driving north or south, as opposed to east, away from the ocean, is a second that you could be putting your life in danger. Doesn't that make sense? If you're driving north or south, the wave is coming at you from the west to east. So every second you're driving north or south, it's a second you could be driving away from the wave. Secondly, you need to be going immediately to higher ground, and these hills here, for instance, are a good example. These hills, 200 to 300 feet above sea level, and you get up to the tops and you're about 700 or 800 feet above sea level. And you've got a few gravel roads that go up these sides. Now, if I lived in the area, I would make note of the generalized tsunami evacuation route that they have for the general public, you know, marked on these public large roads. But then I would also quickly find one of these and jet up it. I wouldn't care if there's somebody with a rifle at the top telling me to get off their land. I'd keep driving and they can shoot because I'm not going to get whisked away in a tsunami because some goofballs trying to protect their land. So you stay on the road, of course, you don't go onto private property, and you try to go up as high as you can. And if you have to go onto private property, so be it. If you have to get out of your car and run up the hill, that's better than trying to drive and save your car. If you watch the Japan tsunami videos from 2011, there are countless people running carrying bags of stuff. Now, the bags they're carrying aren't bug-out bags. It's like bags of stuff they grabbed from their house. Heavy items. Trying to get away, I saw many different women carrying their purses. Okay, you could run faster, you can get higher, either if you have a tsunami exit plan to begin with, you need to have one now. And that's why we're doing this now. So I hope you take this to heart. I hope you have a plan. Your plan needs to be as such. When a large earthquake strikes, like the recording from the Great Shakeout said, sometimes the initial jolt can be so big it can knock people off their feet. And walking, running, or even crawling at some point can be almost impossible. You can do it, but it's hard. And you can fall, and you can break an ankle, you can twist an ankle, you can break a leg. Those things happen when you're running on surfaces that are moving. And in this case, you need a shelter-in-place plan first as you're figuring out whether or not the structure is going to be stable enough. You don't want to be running through the structure in an earthquake. You want to be in a secure place. Things start falling within seconds. And within a minute, you have major devastation. Within 2 minutes, you're at a megaquake level. So I would like you to, again, consider all aspects of this. Have a small earthquake plan. So if it's moderate shaking, maybe a few things are falling off shelves, you'd go underneath your table and desk. And again, not underneath the door frame. According to Great Shakeout and the professionals, door frame is not sufficient. The door frame myth, they say, comes from one of the first earthquake photos to ever make it into the mainstream media. They don't give a date on it, or maybe they do on their website somewhere, but it was a photo from a long time ago that showed a devastated house, and the only thing standing was the door frame, an interior door frame. That's where the rumor or myth comes from, a photo that showed a door frame standing after an earthquake. That's according to them. So they say, don't go under a door frame, go under a table or desk, or to a wall that's going to be away from things that are falling. You need to be prepared for this. Now, know what it is at your workplace, know what it is at your house, and if you're out and about at a restaurant or in a building you're not familiar with, you're going to have to pay attention to where the exits are and what's outside those places beforehand. That's my best advice. If you live on the coastal areas, you need to check your elevation using Google Earth.
Okay, and I will link below to this video, and I will also want to just go back to what he was talking about, Google Earth and the elevation. All right, so Google Earth, most of you probably know this, but the elevation, as you move the mouse or the hand over areas, the elevation actually changes, and the elevation is right down here, right at the bottom of Google Earth, and you'll see it. It's a ELE, and the numbers literally change as you move it across. This really is not about fear-mongering. It is about preparing, and I will show you that 53% of Californians say they are not prepared for an emergency or disaster. And these polls, all right. Well, I would say that there are an awful lot of people who are not prepared for any kind of emergency or any kind of disaster, whether they live in California or any other state. And, you know, there has, years ago, there was a lot of mainstream media and people calling preppers crazy. Crazy. And it's interesting how in the last year we have had our government come out and do these public service announcements telling everybody to prepare. Okay, so preparing now, I don't think comes with an awful lot of derision from our fellow Americans, especially since we have seen so many disasters. But this gives you a list of what you really need to have: water, food, battery-powered or hand-cranked radio, flashlight, first aid kit, extra batteries, whistle to signal for help, dust masks, moist towelettes, wrencher pliers, manual can opener for food, local map, cell phone, chargers and backup batteries. And that you should have already on hand. And depending on your individual or family needs, you can take a look at this list. Prescription or non-prescription medications, glasses, contact lens solution, infant formula, pet food, extra water for your pets, cash or traveler's checks, and I'm not going to read the whole list, but I will link below to everything. Yeah, now it really is very, very important for everybody to be prepared for anything, anything. All links are below. I hope you're all doing well. Stay safe, everybody.